Welcome to episode 40 of Published. Today, I'll speak with Marika Flatt, the co-owner of PR by the Book, a company focused on helping authors elevate their influence and create buzz around their book launch.
Welcome to Published, a podcast by Greenleaf Book Group, where we'll discuss the ins and outs of the publishing industry, from writing a book and finding the right publisher to gearing up for a book launch. And now, here's your host, Greenleaf Book Group CEO, Tanya Hall.
Welcome back to Published. In this episode, we're talking about publication dates. You'll hear us discuss the importance of picking the right publication date for your book and how it factors into an author's PR campaign. Whether your book ties into a certain season or you're trying to avoid publishing during an oversaturated book release period, it's important to be strategic about when you come out with your book, both with your publishers and your publicity and PR team. In this interview, we'll tell you how to choose the perfect pub date for your book and why it's vital to the success of your book's release. Let's get into the interview. All right, Marika, welcome to Published.
It's great to be here. Thanks, yeah, Tanya.
It's great to have you here. We always run into each other in New York, even though we both live here in Austin.
Right. It's crazy. The last time we saw each other was in Nashville.
That's right. So why don't you start by telling us a bit about your background and what you do?
Great. So I started as a baby publicist almost 23 years ago, fresh out of college, and really was in a fantastic environment of kind of sink or swim, really small book publicity firm, got to learn a lot. And when that owner stepped away, I was given a lot of great opportunities to really see what it's like to run the firm. And in 2002, my husband and I started PR by the Book. And so we're a little over 17 years into that. And it's been great. I mean, I've been able to see the evolution of book publicity go from, you know, faxing press releases to tweeting a journalist. So it's been really fun to see how it's changed.
Yeah, and you guys have done a great job staying ahead of that curve. So congrats there.
Thank you.
Publicity relevant. And for people who are listening and don't have the first clue about what that means for an author in terms of marketing PR, can you give us sort of a baseline understanding of what publicity means to an author?
Sure. And I love that you use publicity instead of PR, because I've been having this ongoing conversation lately about the differences, because publicity is really the media relations aspect of getting your book covered by the media. So whether that's in print, online, digital, broadcast media, radio and television. So getting that coverage in the media, that's really the crux of publicity. There's a lot of other things that can fall under PR that relate to setting up a book launch event, you know, even getting potential speaking opportunities, all of those things that could fall under PR. But we really hone in on the publicity aspect, because that in and of itself is kind of a full-time job, just focusing on that. But we do have some clients that we're helping on, you know, the speaking side, or we do some social media support as well, because that's something that's a necessary evil this day for publishers, and a lot of them don't know what to do on their own behalf. So, but primarily it's focused on media relations.
You may have to change the name of your company.
Publicity by the Book.
Yeah.
Right.
So we started chatting in Nashville about the importance of publication dates and how often, frankly, there's some, it's one of those you don't know what you don't know kind of things until it gets screwed up. So maybe start by explaining what the significance is of a specific publication date when you're designing a PR campaign.
Sure. So we have to play by the rules that the media outlets set. And I always tell people, you know, I'm just the messenger with that, because there are some pretty strict rules when you're dealing with the media, because nobody wants to be second. They all want to be first. And so when it comes to publication date, we want that the bulk of the media to start hitting that month. And you know, oftentimes it really needs something in addition, you know, behind it to really push that with the media, give them that call to action. And so timeliness is really important related to that, because if there's hooks that are timely, then that's what we can lean on with the media and say, oh, you know, did you know May is Texas Writers Month, and we've got some Texas writers that you want to support and get the word out about. Without timeliness, there's really not that call to action for the media to say, okay, I'll do it then, I'll do it in this month. And a lot of people come to us with their pub dates already set. And so we work backwards from there. Basically, we say, okay, your publication month is March. And so then we start the research to see what can we utilize in terms of timeliness. But we do have, I would say, probably as many as one third of the people that I talk to on a regular basis. Now with the rise of self-publishing, they're coming to us earlier and earlier. And so I get to have those conversations early sometimes, and I get to consult with them whether they're going to hire us or not, because everybody has access to a free consultation. A lot of times I will give them the honest truth on where they need to be or where they should be in terms of timeliness, and then they can take that advice and run with it and switch up their whole marketing plan around it if they find value in moving their pub date.
Mm-hmm. And I will say that that decision is usually a collaborative decision with the publisher, because you have your own reasons for wanting a certain date. We have ours on
sure.
the publishing side because mm-hmm. of the timelines we have to abide by when we pitch reps and so forth. So
right.
this sometimes, so I think to the author, just seems like just it's an imaginary date. Just change it. And to us,
right.
we're like, no.
Right, right. And so I think the people that I'm able to help in relation to that are people who are going just a strict self-publishing route and who aren't working with the publishing house. They're just going to do it on their own. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they might come to me and say, so I'm going to bring my book out 2 months from now. And then I ask, why? You know, what's your game plan around that? They don't really know. They don't have any reason. And so then we start talking about, okay, well, let's talk about realistic publicity timelines and how long everything takes. And then in addition to that, oh, so your book is for dads? Well, maybe you should think about June, because that's when the media wants to be talking about topics around dads and fatherhood. And so it's just so interesting how many people don't even go through this thought process. And so primarily the ones that I'm giving suggestions to, they're just going to go run with it on their own and self-publish.
Mm-hmm. So what are the implications when an author moves their pub date? Is there ever an instance where, well, you just described one, I suppose, but is there an instance where that's a particularly good idea?
I have been in a situation before where an author was working with a publisher and there was a solid reason to move it up just 1 month from May to April, because there were some tie-ins with not only Mother's Day, but some more random things like Lyme Disease Awareness Month. You know, things that just didn't really cross the minds beforehand. And so we were able to shift it because it was so far in advance when I initially had, it was almost a year in advance when I had that initial conversation with her. So there was a pretty long lead time. I mean, it wasn't a situation where it was going to come out that season and we try to shift it. So that happened pretty seamlessly, but in the end, just that little shift will probably open up a lot more media opportunities, just because we're hitting some really key timeliness right before Mother's Day for her. And so we've actually been on the other end of that, where we've created the strategy, we've created the timeline, and then it needs to get pushed in terms of production for other reasons. And so then we just need to shift around. And honestly, we've had a situation where we thought a book was coming out in the spring and then it ends up coming out in the fall. And so what we ended up doing is the timeliness that we had pulled, all these ideas for hooks and angles, we just ended up pitching those long lead for the following spring, long lead print magazines. Mm-hmm. And it actually worked out fine. And so we just have to be nimble, but, you know, we do that. I mean, it's not heart surgery. So, you know, we can we can kind of play around with it a little bit.
Right. So when our authors who are listening now are potential authors, people who aspire to be authors, probably have not gone through a book publicity campaign before. So can you describe in general terms, what would they expect as far as activity around their pub date?
Yeah, so when you start thinking of the longer timeline and you think, okay, there might be advanced review copies that go out anywhere from 3 to 6 months prior to pub date to longer lead outlets, which would include book trade publications, top tier media, if there's national broadcast media that's a fit. So we want to get an advanced look to people far enough down the road that they can make some plans. A lot of our campaigns end up starting 2 months prior to pub date. And that's when we move into the short lead phase of pitching short lead media outlets. And short lead media outlets would consist of all the online and digital opportunities out there, radio and television opportunities, daily newspapers, that person's local media. So everything that doesn't get thrown into the long lead bucket is in the short lead bucket. And so the idea behind it is that you want to have that media hitting the month that the book's coming out. So there's actually a pretty detailed runway that happens in that 2 months leading up to it to make those hits coming out, because it's not just like we call someone up and then something's landed, you know, the next day. So there's a process where, you know, we start out by writing very particular press materials that we think are going to get the media's attention. We go in, we start curating media lists based on the type of book. If it's a novel, you know, we're building those people who we have the best shot with, or maybe we have a wish list that we're putting together. If it's, let's say, health and wellness, you know, we're going a different direction with the media. And so we spend some time getting those media lists ready to go. And then when the press materials are written, edited in-house, approved by the client, and we've got those media lists ready to go, then we start pitching. And so that might be, let's say, week 3 into the campaign, sometimes week 4 if the author takes a little bit longer to get back to us. And then, so if you consider that that's 2 months prior to the pub date, then in that month prior to pub date, we're pitching, we're following up, we're getting people what they need, because they might get back to us and say, love it, sounds great, I'd like a review copy. So then when you get them the review copy, you've got to give them time to read it. And then there's more follow-up that happens after that. And you're just continuing to reach out to people who would be appropriate, getting them the materials they need, so that in that month of pub date, you've got media secured to start hitting to the end consumer. And one of the things that works really great that we do fairly often are our virtual book tours, which that's a great way to get the groundswell of all that digital activity happening the week that the book comes out. And so you've got all this buzz happening. You might have 20 different bloggers, podcasters, bookstagrammers, online reviewers, 20, 30 people talking about your book in that given week. And that's great to just launch that campaign off with that buzz.
Yeah, definitely. And I suppose maybe we should take a step back and help people understand the reason why publicity is so important to support a book launch. A lot of folks don't realize when we talk about retail distribution, the book business is very strange in that everything is returnable. So
right.
It's essentially consignment. And when your publisher or distributor gets the books out, of course, into Barnes and Noble, they have maybe a 60-day window. That's been shrinking over the years, but maybe a 60-day window to be sold, or they come back to us and that undoes the sale for everybody and makes us all quite sad. So
yes.
This publicity
nobody
is,
likes that.
Yes, the publicity element is so essential for creating that demand that gets what I call the second sale to happen. The first sale is into our retail accounts, second sale is to the consumer.
Right. So I've always said, without publicity, the book's just sitting there on the shelf. And a lot of authors think, oh, I'm going to get this book done, and it's going to get published, and it's going to get out there, and it's just going to fly off the shelf. But if nobody's hearing about it, then because, especially now, I mean, now in this day and age, our attention spans are so short, we're so busy, we have such little time to even go to a bookstore and browse, which was unlike, you know, 15 years ago, you know, I could spend a whole Saturday browsing around a Barnes & Noble. And, you know, they're just not doing that anymore. So we have to get right up in front of the consumer, and we have to tell them why they need the book. And that can come in a variety of different ways. You know, I can't tell you how many books I've personally bought that were mentioned either in a magazine article that I read, or I'm listening to a podcast and someone says, this was the best book, you've got to get it, it helps because. And so we've just, you know, we can't take it for granted that somebody's just going to stumble upon and discover a book because it's sitting on the shelf in the store. You know, we have to be telling over and over and over again through radio, television, online, print, that it's out there and that it's available. And then when you build up that momentum, which you start to see, I like to think of it as kind of a wave in the ocean. You kind of see it start to build in that month of pub date. And then it just, you want to ride it and you want to see it continue to build more and more and more, so that in a perfect world, you would have a campaign running several months after pub date. So you just continue to build on that momentum, and more people are finding out about it. And it's not just that short flash in the pan. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the worst things an author can do is to end their publicity campaign at the end of the month that the book came out. And it's just kind of like, oh, wow, you've got this way, but it just fell, you know, and you're not writing it. You're not building that momentum. And as publicists, it kind of breaks our heart because you've worked so hard to get to that point. So I know for an author, it seems like a very long-term endeavor, but it is. I mean, it's branding. It's building up name recognition. It's building up the title recognition. And, you know, overall, the publicity campaign should be getting that author to the goals that they set before they hired a publicist. And what is that? Is it book sales? Is it speaking engagements? Is it more business for their company? Is it building up their name recognition so they can have other opportunities, other doors open for them down the road? I mean, there's a whole host of reasons, but publicity factors into all of those goals.
Yeah, definitely. And I can tell you from my own experience writing a book, there's this strange magical thinking that happens when you, and I did it myself, I know better and I did it, but you take on this very difficult task of writing a book, and it's so hard for most people that mm-hmm. by the time you finish, you think, well, things that are really hard to do generally are praised and rewarded. And that's not necessarily going to be the case if you don't carry on with the publicity. But as an author, you're probably fairly fatigued right. by that point. And it's important to mentally prepare that you've got to grind through it and do the PR, whether you like it or not.
Right, right. Absolutely.
So what can an author do to prepare for that? We've been talking about how important that is to build that wave and then keep writing it, as you say. So how can they prepare for that very important phase?
Right. So, you know, preparation is the first step in we've developed a 5-step success path that we chart from preparation to promotion. Preparation's the first and promotion's the fifth. So there's 3 in between there. But preparing is so important to get ready. And that starts early on to, one, make sure you have a great book and not trying to just put something out there that's not the very best. It's not putting your best foot forward.
Shotgun publishing, we call that.
Yes. And that's a shame because I see it all the time. I see people come across my desk and I tell them, you know, this isn't putting your best foot forward because, you know, there's problems with the content. It hasn't been adequately edited. This book cover looks self-published. You know, all of those pieces that you have to go into planning. And even before all that, because that's really based on the product, but even before all that, it's starting out planning, who is my audience? Who am I speaking to? And why should they care that this is coming out now and from me? So there's all these steps that an author should go through early on at the beginning when they just have a book in their heart, or maybe they've got half of it written or whatever, to really figure out who's going to buy this book and why now? And then it kind of goes from there of really, you know, making sure that the platform is there. And the platform is another step in our success path. So what that looks like is social media platforms that people care to look at and that are engaging, perhaps a great website that's contemporary enough. It doesn't look like it was created 20 years ago. Making sure that your platform represents you. And that's just an extension of your book in the very end when we're pitching. So there's all those steps that an author has to be aware of before they even get to the publicity stage, because those are assets for the publicity phase. If everything else looks good, if it's a great book and it's clear on who the audience is and what the value is and the branding looks good, then all of that factors into the success of the publicity campaign.
Yeah, definitely. I think I see authors frequently underestimate how much planning should go into this. And so hopefully they'll listen to this podcast and understand they should start early.
Yes.
Circling back to, you mentioned Father's Day as an example of a seasonal tie-in. How important are those seasonal tie-ins when you're speaking with an author about selecting a pub date?
It really makes a big difference because it gives us something to kind of bite onto, you know. And, you know, some examples, you know, there's big ones like February is Black History Month, March is Women's History Month, and May is Mental Health Awareness Month. Those are big ones. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. So there's really big ones that most media outlets are aware of. But then there's kind of that next tier that media outlets might not be aware of. And they might look at our pitch and go, oh my gosh, April 27th is Tell a Story Day. I better get an author in here because wouldn't that be fun? And so some of those we're educating the media on. So we spend a bit of time, not only in the proposal stage, but also in our brainstorming stage when a campaign kicks off, looking at those things of, you know, okay, what makes the most sense for a media outlet? You know, if they are, maybe they don't interview authors, maybe let's say it's a morning news show in their local market, and maybe they don't interview authors on a regular basis, but they get our pitch and they see, oh, wow, July is picnic month. It would be so fun to have this cookbook author in. And basically, we're creating the segment idea for them. How fun would that be for the author to bring in a picnic basket and have one of their recipes that's in the book displayed and talk about it? And why is it great to use for a picnic? And it's July, and since it's picnic month, let's talk about that. And so, you know, some of those things we're introducing to the media, and like we were talking about earlier, if there's no timeliness, honestly, it's just another book coming out in another month. And you and I know how many books come out a year, and, you know, that person, that author can't just be another book because those are a dime a dozen. So what makes it unique? What makes it timely? Because if you really think about the goals for the media outlet, you know, they have their own goals. And ultimately, they've got to sell advertising. And so to sell advertising, they've got to have viewers, listeners, readers. And so they're thinking, what type of content can I put out there to get the most response? And so you kind of have to work backwards in their mentality too. And if it's just, you know, a novel that's coming out that really doesn't tie into much, but yet, you know, Memorial Day is coming up and they have their choice. Do I bring on this novelist that there's no timeliness, there's no hook? Or do I bring on someone related to the military, soldier, who can talk about Memorial Day? They're always going to pick the timeliness. And they're always going to make that choice because that's what their viewers and listeners and readers want to see.
Yes. And as a former television producer, I can tell you that there's nothing they like more than when someone else does their job for them.
Right. Exactly. That's what we always
favorite
say.
Publicist.
Yep. When I'm training publicists or working with interns, I always say, you know, a big part of our job is to do the media's work for them because they're busy and they don't have time to check all these boxes, nor do they have time to read the book itself. So we've got to do their job and make it easy.
Definitely. Yeah, that's it. The cue of a good publicist right there.
Well, and I started out in media too, so that's the direction I wanted to go. And so I think that that trajectory that I chose when I was 18 and got involved in a cable TV station helped me be a better publicist after I graduated from college, because I already had seen that environment. I had seen TV, I had seen print, I had seen a daily newspaper, and I knew, like, what are their challenges? You know, what are they dealing with? And how can I, as a publicist, meet those needs to be a valuable resource to them? And that's really what a good publicist is doing, is being a resource.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely agree. So is there a worst time of year for an author to release their book?
I kind of get on my soapbox about this sometimes on phone calls with authors, because it makes me cringe when I hear that a book's coming out in November or December, and there's no reason for it. There's no holiday timeliness. There's nothing, because, and you would probably be surprised at how often I hear this, because what I tell people is, let's say you put a December pub date on that and nobody's really paying attention in December to what we're saying to them. And so they're busy, you know, it's hard for us to get a response. Guess what? On January 1st, your book is all of a sudden old to the media, because it's the next year and it might have only been 3 weeks down the road. And therefore, what you've done is taken a window that could have lasted months and months long, and you've compacted it down to a couple of weeks, because now your publication date is last year. And so I cringe when I see that with authors, that why don't you just wait until January? And then you've got that new publication year. You've got all that time that you can utilize all these evergreen angles and really utilize the timing to your ability, versus having this tiny little window where, you know, people are going to look up and think, wow, that book came out last year, you know, and you're thinking, well, that's not fair. It just came out 6 weeks ago or whatever. And that's just the nature of it.
Yeah, I would have given the same advice. And on the distribution side, it's also tremendously difficult to get books into bookstores November and December.
I bet.
First of all, those are booked out probably back in January. And second, it's so crowded. It's insane. It's just very, very difficult to get anything placed in November and December. And then, yeah, people are so distracted. I agree. And we don't want to have an old book on our hands, like you said, 6 months after it, 6 weeks rather, after it comes out.
Right. And you probably have situations that come up where, you know, let's say an author wanted a book to come out in November for some reason, and you're trying to get them to steer away from that. And another thing that comes to mind is, what if they want to do a book launch signing at an independent bookstore? They're not going to get in November and December, because that programming was booked up, like you said, months and months and months in advance. So that opportunity is gone for them as well. Mm-hmm. So you really have to look at it holistically.
Yeah, I definitely agree. So thinking about 2020, the year ahead of us, are there any seasons you or months that you would avoid or recommend when you're thinking about what's coming up for this year?
Well, the first thing that comes to mind is November, yes, around the presidential season. So, you know, I remember this so vividly from 4 years ago when we came across the same situation. And wow, is it challenging in the fall to get authors that had no political angles and hooks any type of media, because the press didn't want to talk about anything else. And so, yes, it happens. Yes, we're able to get those media hits during that time. But I feel like it's just good to go in with eyes wide open and know, okay, this is going to be up on us before we know it. So that's the first one that comes to mind for me in terms of 2020. And Somebody just told me recently that the Summer Olympics are happening this year. And that I was kind of like, wait a minute, I haven't heard anything about that. Really? And so, you know, I think that it's smart to kind of look through the year and think, okay, are there times, whether it's going to be a 2-week period or a month or whatever, that the media really will be focused on one particular topic? And if it's outside your realm of expertise, then, you know, it's just going to be a challenge. And again, I mean, it doesn't mean that you have to change up your timing and just scrap everything and start fresh. But going in with those eyes wide open and knowing, okay, there's going to be potentially a challenge here or a challenge there, and figuring out how to navigate that and maybe do something a little bit different during that time frame is always helpful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Well, you've been so generous with your insights around these things today. Is there any other advice you'd like to share with our listeners?
I just really am such an advocate of starting to think about those press opportunities in the very beginning stages of writing or even thinking about the book. You know, when it's in just a little bubble in your heart, you know, to start thinking, okay, how can I get this out to the world? You know, what does my megaphone look like? And yeah, that might be 2 years from that particular point in time, 3 years, whatever. But to really have that in the back of your mind and know that, also another thing about that is to not view publicity as an afterthought in terms of your budgeting, because I come across that as well, where they just don't even think about it. And then they've used up their entire budget and they just don't have any money to spend on it. And that's a sad thing too, because they didn't do that on purpose. They didn't realize, they didn't know. It's all about educating and thinking ahead and thinking, okay, I want to save this much over here so that I can publicize my book, you know, when it's coming out. And so I just think that's something that people just honestly don't think about enough.
Yeah, agreed. They can learn a lot about it in my book, Ideas, Influence, and Income. And then you've just launched a course. Do you want to share a bit about
that? Yes, we're really excited about the Author to Influencer Accelerator that is just off the ground. It's been something that's kind of been percolating for a couple of years now. And it kind of goes back to the what I just talked about a lot of authors not having the budget to hire a professional to do it for them. You know, I have these conversations and kind of breaks my heart when somebody really wants to publicize their book and the money's just not there. And so this course is developed, it's kind of a DIY approach. So people who want to get into this membership community and learn. So there's a library of resources already inside the platform when people come in, and there's a monthly fee. And basically they come in and they start learning right off the bat. They go at their own pace because they can listen or watch these courses on their own time and learn from each. Each one has a handout to go along with it so that they actually, they listen to it and then take action on how they need to plan out. And so it goes from, it follows that success path that I mentioned, preparation, platform, product, planning, and then promotion. And so the education comes not only from my own workshops, but also my friends in the industry like you who come with their own specialty and knowledge. And then we'll do success stories and member spotlights. And one of my favorite things is going to be Q&A office hours with me, where people can just come in at that particular time and get all their questions answered. So it's a very low cost for people. It's at authortoinfluenceracelerator.com. And, you know, that's just another option for people out there who want to promote, but they don't have thousands of dollars to hire a professional to handle it for them.
Yeah, awesome. Well, thanks for sharing that with us, and thanks for joining us on Published.
Happy to be here. Thank you.
That's it for our episode today. We hope you enjoyed learning about publication dates with Marika. For notes and resources from today's show, go to greenleafbookgroup.com/episode40. You can also find advice for writing, publishing, and promoting your work in my book, Ideas, Influence, and Income, which you can learn more about at ideasinfluenceandincome.com. If you've enjoyed our show, please rate and review us on iTunes. It means a lot to have your feedback and certainly helps us to make sure we're answering your most burning publishing questions. A big Big thank you to Eleanor Fishbourne, who produces the Published podcast. We'll be back next month with another new episode.
Thanks for listening to Published. To learn more, please visit greenleafbookgroup.com. And remember to subscribe to this podcast on iTunes.